Hello everyone, welcome to part 7, module 6, data communication. So far till part 6 we discussed the circuit switching concept. Now we are move on to our discussion on packet switching. So before starting packet switching concept, let's see what are all the limitations of circuit switching that we already know, and just I summarized here. And due to this limitation, we started thinking of a new approach. So the the long haul circuit switching telecommunications networks was originally designed to handle voice traffic, and the majority of the traffic on this network continues to be voice. So for voice based telephone communication, the circuit switching is originally established, right? So and for voice communication, still the circuit switching concept is continuing, and it is working fine also. Because even though we have a resource dedicated for our communication, we are simply communicating, right? So once our communication is over, we can go to the tear down phase and we can free up all the resources. It is not a problem. But when you are applying this concept into data communication, the normal network communication, we have the problems. So a key characteristic of the circuit switching network is that the resources within the network are dedicated for a particular call. So that resource being dedicated, that is a problem here. But when it comes to voice connection, the resulting circuit will enjoy a high percentage of utilization, because most of the time one party or the other will be talking. That means even though you are dedicating your resources, it will be utilized continuously. In case of voice traffic, there is no issue. Now when it comes to circuit switching, when we started applying it for the data connection, we have two shortcomings become apparent, just like so. That is what we are already seeing. Like when it comes to telephone communication, that is when it comes to voice communication, there is no big issue. But for the other data connection, like network connection, it may arise problems. Like first one, in a typical user host data connection, that is example, a personal computer user logged on to a database server, for example, a user logged on to a database server or something else, much of the time the line is idle. Okay, that you can imagine. You just initiated the connection, but you don't want to do some kind of transaction or some communication. So it that line that is being permanently dedicated will be idle, and this will with the data connection, a circuit switching approach is inefficient. So when it comes to data connection application like this, the circuit switching will be inefficient, because most of the time the circuit being dedicated is not utilized. Sorry, it is underutilized. And another thing is, in a circuit switch network, the connection provides for transmission at a constant data rate. Between a sender and receiver, once the connection is established, the particular channel that is being used in the connection will be having, will be providing some fixed data rate, and that only will be getting for both the sender and the receiver. So we have a kind of constant data rate. But if our application is like it is supporting a bulky traffic, that means for a long period of time it don't want to send some data, but when it want to communicate some information, say it is communicating some bulky traffic, or it want variable data rate, in that kind of application the circuit switching concept is not suitable. So thus each of the two devices that are connected must transmit and receive at the same data rate as the other. So that is a requirement for circuit switching. So this limits the utility of a network in interconnecting a variety of host computers and workstation with the dynamic data rate requirement. So to solve these two issues, particularly the packet switching is introduced to address these problems. So now if we can see the concept of packet switching that I already mentioned, like when we have a long message, the first thing is we are going to divide that information into small packets. In circuit switching concept, no such division of information into packet is there. Simply the entire message will be communicated from the sender to the receiver without any packeting concept. But here the information will be divided into packets. So data is transmitted in short packets. So what about the size of a packet? It's typically means upper bound of a packet could be 1000 octets, but it is not like that. This value is determined by considering lot of parameters. What could be an ideal size of a packet? Some network it may be more than this 1000 octets, sometimes it may be less than that, but this is a kind of average value that is even not listed in your textbook. But if you are looking at the IP network and all, the value is different actually. So if a source has a longer message to send, the message is broken into a series of packets of fixed size. Not fixed size, maximum it will be like 1000 octets on an average. Or it may be less than that also, up to the size of the message. So now each packet contains a portion of the user's data plus some control information. So that is the thing here. The information will be divided into different packets. Now, in addition to the information, along with each packet, you have to attach something called a control information. Now, once a single message is being divided into, say, 10 pieces, and all these pieces will be using different routes. So everybody has to finally reach the receiver, and some kind of synchronization is needed. And all those synchronization information, address information, all those things are what we call as control information. So that has to be added with each and every packet, okay, by means of something called a header. And it's a kind of overhead also. And we will see, it's we need a balance between all this. Now, the control information at a minimum includes the information that the network requires to be able to route the packet through the network and deliver to the internet destination. As I already told you, when you are dividing your message into different packets, each packet will be taking different route, right? Now, on the way, the intermediate switching nodes has to take your packet, it has to process, it has to deliver the packet to the appropriate outgoing link, and finally it should reach the destination. And all those supporting information, including the address of the destination and other control information, together makes the control information or the header field. Now, each node on the route, the packet is received, stored briefly, and passed on to the next node. And this is something called a store and forward approach. And on the way to the intermediate nodes, intermediate switching nodes, the packets would be getting stored, and it will be processed for some time. And if processed in the sense, during that processing, the intermediate switches are actually identifying the path to which this packet is to be transmitted, because there is no predefined packet as that we seen in case of circuit switching. So that is called a store and forward approach. Every intermediate switching nodes will be storing your packet, and it will process it, and if everything is fine, it will identify an outgoing link and it will forward through that link. Such a store and forward approach is not there in case of circuit switching, where you can see a continuous flow of information. Okay, there is no delay in between. And here there is no resource reservation at all. The resources are allocated on demand. So what we are generally calling as packet switching principle, where there is no reservation as well as information divided into packets, is actually called as datagram technique. Okay, and in packet switching itself, we try to take some of the concepts of this circuit switching, and this pure form of packet switching and circuit switching together, we have a concept called virtual circuiting also. Normally it is coming under it is explained as a particular subdivision of this packet switching principle in general. But even though it is a subdivision of packet switching principle, you can see the features of circuit switching and packet switching, the pure form of packet switching, that is the datagram switching, together into that virtual circuit concept that we will see. But all these definitions, everything applicable for the pure packet switching concept, okay. And when it comes to virtual circuit, variations are there. Now, the concept of packet, it is like this is a sender machine, and it is trying to communicate with the receiver through a packet switching network. Now, if you are looking at the application data, it is being divided into, say, three packets, for example. Similarly, at the receiver side, all these three are combined into the message at the receiver side. Now, along with each packet, we are adding the control information, and this portion is called the packet header. Okay. Now, the header plus the part of the information from the original message together make the packet. Okay. Similarly at the receiver, and this header is something carrying information that is helping this packet to travel through the network and reach the receiver, and also for the synchronization, error control, all those informations are there in the pack header. But in case of circuit switching also, in that case we will not divide information like this, but instead the information as a whole will be carrying a single header. But now the problem is the same header information you have to replicate at each and every packet. So how many packets you are going to divide your information, that many times you have to replicate this information. This is a problem here, okay? And because this is actually an overhead. This header is okay, because the original message is also having this much of header, and that is here. But these two are overhead. So we will always try to minimize overhead and with maximum efficiency. So accordingly, we have to determine a good value for the packet size. Now, another concept that you can think about is the pipelining concept. And that is what we already seen in the computer organization, where the information, a pipelining, you know, right? The total processing of an instruction, you will divide into different phases, like instruction fetch, decode, execute, and the phases will be overlapped at the processor. And similarly, here you can see a kind of pipelined processing at the intermediate nodes. So it is like this. Here, the original message is being divided into, say, three packets, so that each packet is having some information like this, or we can think of it like there is no division at all. The original message, three different messages, like the division. So one packet message. Okay, so the packet is, the message is just one packet like that. So here we are trying to communicate three different messages. Each message is just a single packet, and in this case, the same message we divide it into two packets. That means two packets per message. Okay, and here the same information is being divided into five packets. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Together make a single message. Okay, so five packet per single message. Here it is divided into 10 packets, and per a single message. Single message divided into 10 packets. So different scenario you can see. So as the same information is being divided like this, you can see that the data portion is getting smaller, right? And the header information here per message, we have a single header information. Now when you divided that single message into two packets, I mean data one and data two, two packets of the same message, you can see that the header information is two times here, and this is an overhead. Okay, and here you can see it is five times. Out of that, only the minimum requirement, and other four header informations are overhead. Here the overhead is more, right? And the actual information within a packet is very small in size also. That is the thing. Now what is happening at the intermediate nodes is how we are achieving this pipelining is like this. In the when the message is a single packet, I mean when there is no division of the message, simply that message as a whole will be coming to the intermediate switch, and it will process the message as a whole. It will try to process the message as a whole, and in that time means it can't divide the process of whenever a message is coming, what the switch has to do, it will look at the header information, and it will determine the actual appropriate outgoing link, and through that link it will try to send the message, right? So the whole thing has a process together. Now a series of activity, like look at the header and interpret the header. Once you interpret the header, identify the outgoing link. And those things now you can do like this. That means here, when you are looking at the switch, it is switch intermediate switch. The first intermediate switch is getting this packet. That means data one of message one. And it is processing that. Okay, so once that processing is over, now the second part of the packets arrived at the switch. Okay, and when the switch is actually processing, I mean this data too, at the same time it can handle the first sub part of the second message. Okay, the handling in the sense, the overall process, that means looking at the header, identifying the path, just like what happened in the normal pipelining for an instruction, the overall execution of the instruction, you divide it into fetch, decode, execute, like that. Here also the overall processing of a particular message, you divide into different phases, so that when here you can divide that process of the switch into two parts, so that the first data one of that this particular part of message one is being processed by the second part of the switch, the data one of the second message can be processed by the first part of the switch, because that part is being free and it is handed over to the second part like this. So that is how we are achieving pipelining. And now when it comes to the the information is being divided into, say, five packets like this, you can see that the three things are being parallelly executed. Here also three things, but if you want, you can execute more things also. Like here three execution is shown. It is something like the processing of the single message, the fourth stage is going on this particular switch. At the same time, the third stage of the processing of message two is going on at the same switch. On the same time, the second part of, the whole message is like this, the second part of message 2, message 3 is being handled at the same switch. Now, if it want, it can start processing of the first part of the switch also in parallel. Okay, and going to the next level, you can see like the fifth part of the message 1, fourth part of message 2, third part of message 3, and you can continue like this. Second part of message 4, and so actually it is like this is the fresh message, okay? So because these things are in front of the pipelining, these are queued on the back side. So the last, I mean, let me call this as message 5, this is message 4, this is message 3. 2 and 1 are in front of it, that is not shown in the figure, you just imagine that. So what is happening here, the fifth part of message 1, fourth part of message 2, third part of message 3, like that, two more things can be parallelly executed, that's all. Similarly, if you extend this concept, that means when the information is being divided into 10 packets, means the switch should be capable of processing a particular message into 10 different segments, and all those 10 segments of the switch processing should be parallelly executed, then only we will get the benefit. Okay, so assume so, because just like the concept of pipelining that you applied in the normal processing of an instruction, here in message processing also you can apply it, and in that way we are actually getting benefit when it comes to packet switching. Okay, so why that packeting, that is what I'm trying to convey here. You just correlate this concept with the pipelining concept that you studied in CO. So this in particular single instruction processing, you divide it into different stages. Similarly, the processing of a particular message, you divide it into different stages, and those stages should be parallelly executable also. In that case only you can achieve some pipelining concept like this. Okay, that's all. And okay, let me just conclude some this presentation with the advantages of packet switching over circuit switching. One benefit is like the line efficiency is greater, right? Of course, because a single node to node link can be dynamically shared by many packets over time. Means now there is no dedicated path, of course the same channel communication path will be shared by more than one messages. So the packets are queued up and transmitted as rapidly as possible over the link, by contrast with circuit switching. With circuit switching, time on a node to node link is pre-allocated. Okay, so in circuit switching you can see the pre-allocation of the communication channel, but here there is no pre-allocation, and accordingly dynamically many packets can share the particular line. So sharing is more here, or line efficiency is greater here. Now another benefit here is the packet switching network can perform data rate conversion, just like what we in circuit switching we have a requirement like a fixed data rate is what is provided by it, but here you can think of varying data rate by dividing the information to packets, and we can achieve accordingly. Okay, because there is no pre-allocation on the way, and which node is giving me more data rate, accordingly I can choose and I can take that path. So two stations of different data rates can exchange packets, because each connect to its node at its proper data rate. In that way it can choose and it can have the communication. Now when the traffic becomes very heavy on circuit switching network, normally the calls are getting blocked. We already seen what we preferred is non-blocking or nearly blocking kind of communication. That is what we can achieve with the packet switching, because in case of circuit switching, as it is pre-allocation, before starting communication you are supposed to allocate, it is not in a on-demand allocation. So definitely if channels are not available, there are chances of blocking, but if you want to avoid this blocking, accordingly the circuit has to be more complex. So that is, the network refuses to accept additional connection request until the load on the network decreases. So on packet switching network, the packets are still accepted, but delivery delay may increase. So once the load is increasing, here it will simply block or deny the new connection, but here normally still it will accept the packets, with means the individual users will not be getting a feel like the particular connection is blocked. It is not like that, simply it will accept packets, but on the way, because of traffic, the packets may be queued at the intermediate switches and the delay may increase. So the delay may increase, but still that blocking they try to avoid. Now priorities can be used, of course, when many packets are arriving at the intermediate switches, you can prioritize them and you can give a special consideration for those packets which are part of some specific communication. So if a node has a number of packets queued for transmission, it can transmit the higher priority packets first, which will thus experience less delay than the lower priority packets. Okay, that's all the discussion on packet switching. So packet switching, The main thing is like the information being divided into different packets, and the header information or the control information is being attached with each and every packet. So that is the concept here. And store and forward approach, of course, at on demand, on the way, the intermediate switches are going to determine where to forward the packet, and there is no pre-allocated path in the pure form of packet switching. And of course, we have all these benefits here, and that pipelining efficiency also we can make use of, provided the intermediate switches should be so should support that pipelining, then only. Okay, thank you.